Good evening.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and He will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome, 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 everyone, to prayer service and Bible study, first Wednesday of October 2019. Amen. 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 Let's just dive right into it. Let's have a little bit of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you once again for just being just so loving towards your children. Lord, thank you for the angel of this house, our senior pastor, Bobby McKenzie. Lord, thank you for the First Lady of Macedonia and Sister Justine McKenzie. Lord, thank you for allowing us all to be members of this great church congregation here at 1010 Chauncey Street. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Lord, thank you for allowing us to gather once again as a corporate body of believers to actually pray for ourselves, for this ministry, and for the city of Albion and the surrounding areas. Lord, thank you for the lesson that will come from on high this evening to show us what you want us to know so we can do what you called us to do. Lord, we love you, we glorify you, we adore you. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray, and the church say together, amen. Amen. So, welcome everybody.
Yes, sir.
Ain't God good?
All the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know about y'all, but I went and had a little vacation and saw a young man actually downtown Indianapolis. He had a portable speaker, and that brother just started talking about the goodness of the Lord. Right before the Circle City Classic Parade, he actually went through a 3-point sermon while everybody was just sitting there waiting on the parade to start. I was like super inspired. He just talked about how good God is. And I'm looking at the goodness of the Lord in this place. I mean, we did not have to wake up this morning. But it was only by the goodness of the Lord that we did. One of the residents that I had the privilege of teaching for 3 months at Bishop Grand Villa actually transitioned this morning. And it was like, wow, really? He was a Spartan fan, but we got along pretty good. But it's just like, God is so gracious towards us that He allows us chance after chance after chance after chance to do this thing with righteousness or His right way of doing things. Amen?
Amen.
My God. So let's dive right into it. Let's dive right into it. Our first prayer for the night will be our prayer of just thanks. Amen.
Amen.
I just really want to just let God know how much we thank Him for doing what only He could do, for paying a price that He could. Before we do that, do y'all realize what God did for us? Do y'all realize what Jesus did for us? Jesus was convicted of a crime that He never committed. He simply was telling the religious leaders of the time who He was. And they believed that He was committing blasphemy. They actually believed that He was discriminating against the name of God for simply telling who He was. And He did it for a group of people that didn't even love Him. He died for the souls of the ones who ended up killing Him. I don't know about y'all, but that's some love right there. He went to that cross, and He allowed them, now hear my words, He allowed them to put nails in His hand. He allowed them to put a spike through His feet. He allowed them to put a crown of thorns with 2-inch spikes on it on His head. They spit on Him, they mocked Him, and He did all of that. And the scripture says at the appropriate time, He gave up the ghost.
Yeah.
He died. They didn't kill Him. He chose to die because He was about His Father's business. He stayed dead, and on that third day morning, He got up. And He did all of that for us.
Amen.
Amen.
That was the love show.
He did all of that for people that didn't even love Him back. Man, I don't know about y'all, but that just fills me. It actually humbles me. So when we get in our feelings about stuff, when we kind of start believing that we are more than who we really are. When we actually start having attitudes with people that we should be loving on, take a moment to think about what Jesus did for you. Think about the grace and the mercy he gave us, and how we should be able to give that same grace and mercy to another brother or sister in Christ. Amen. My God. God is good. 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 And I love him. I love him. Minister Spicer, I love him. I love him. I love him. Look, I hope I don't get emotional, but I'm just telling you, I love him. Because if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? Amen? My God, man. I think about sometimes how Brother Will Atkins used to make me read the scriptures at work when I was at Wolverine and I was his apprentice. And he used to force me, and I'm going to tell you, it was against my will. That dude used to force me to go and sit down before I would start my work day and read a verse. And I'm going to tell you, I did not want to do it. But had it not been for the relationship that was built back then, I wouldn't be here today in 2019 in front of this great group of believers. Amen? So, man, I would thank you publicly for what you did in my life, young man. Amen? All right, so, yeah. So, where was I at?
1 Thessalonians 5:18.
No, that ain't what I want.
Are you one out of here?
Oh.
That's what I got.
Well, since you got it, go ahead and read it, D.
All right, let me read 1 Thessalonians 5:18.
Yeah.
In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you.
Amen, amen. That was a pretty good reading that, D. I put the sweet potato back like I asked you to. Amen. So just for 2 minutes, based off of 1 Thessalonians, we're just going to give God thanks. Amen. Please stand. So we can pray, because he says, when you stand praying, amen, amen, thank you for your obedience. 2 minutes on that one. Ready? And go. Sanders, Sister Elizabeth Carter, Brother Joseph Caldwell, and Brother Denzel Branderson. Our known special prayer request list are Sister Gertrude Barton, Sister Luella Patterson, Brother Ivan Green, and Brother John Hitchison. Any other sick and shut in, special prayer request list, or prayers for bereaved families? Brother Brian.
Perilee Bowman.
Sister Perilee Bowman. Amen. Deacon Bowman.
Homegoing service with Gerald Taylor, his brother's brother-in-law.
Amen. So comfort for the Taylor family.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Sister Jo.
My family, my cousin transitioned last Sunday.
Amen.
And I'm happy she's 101.
My God. My God.
She's very active. I see 100 and a half.
Amen. Amen. So. Comfort for the Atkins family in the transitioning of their cousin.
My name is Nell Mothershed.
For the family of Nell Mothershed.
And the Hood family.
And the Hood family.
Etchison.
And the Etchison family. Amen. Sister Mariel. Prayer comfort for the Lockett family. Amen. Sister Bree. Special prayer request for the Bree. The White and the Bennett family. Amen. Sorry about that. Sister Addie.
Yes, also a bereavement for my family. I lost my first cousin in Akron, Ohio, and prayers requested for his family. And special prayer request for the Chapman.
So, what's your cousin's name?
I'm sorry, Roy Rogers.
So, prayer of comfort for the Rogers family, and special prayer request for the Chapman and the Lewis family. Amen. Sister McGeer.
Sister Sue Clark.
Sister Sue Clark. And we're going to throw the McGeer family in there, especially my buddy Joe. Amen.
Amen.
Sister Reed.
Sister Barb
Gladden. Sister who?
Barb
Gladden. Amen. Sister Markeisha.
My dad's family, the Hampton family, and the Newton. Hi, everyone.
Special prayer for the, what's the name again? The Clark family?
Nichols.
The Clark and Nichols families?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Sister Ranisha.
The McKenzie family.
The McKenzie family.
The Macedonian family.
The Macedonian family.
The Maston family.
The Maston family.
And a prayer, a special prayer that Christians all over the world do a better job at loving one another.
Special prayer request for Christians worldwide to love one another. Amen. In the balcony.
You got one?
You got one?
Me?
Yeah, you.
No.
Oh. No, I'm just reading. Pastor Bobby McKenzie. Sister Bo.
Special prayer request for Dorian Lattimore because she can't seem to stay out of trouble at school. And she's always in the office, and the child needs some help, and she needs a lot of prayer.
Amen. Pray for Sister Dorian Lattimore for getting her behavior under control. Amen. Brother Ronnie.
Pray for the Wilson family.
Pray for the Wilson family. Amen. I'll throw my families in there, the Gibson and the Lowe families. Amen. Anybody else? Sister Etchison. The Sanders family. Sister Mamie.
Beulah Hampton.
For Sister Beulah Hampton. Amen. Miss Craig, Miss Faye.
Craig family.
For the Craig family. Amen. Deacon Bowman.
Special prayer request for teachers all over this country.
Amen.
Who need
Amen.
To have support in the classroom.
Amen.
Because they're dealing with some stuff that you just won't know.
Amen. Amen. Prayer for teachers everywhere.
Yeah,
for what they've been called to do as far as educating our children.
Yes.
Amen. Brother Will.
Special prayer for our President and our
Amen.
Government.
Amen. Amen. Prayer for Donald Trump, our president, for the for Congress, for all the legislatures on the national, the state, and the local level. Amen. Sister Alexis. Prayer for those who are homeless and that they will find shelter as the weather gets more inclement. Amen. Sister Robbie.
For the Patterson family.
For the Patterson family. Amen.
For Ruth Lattimore.
Sister Ruth Lattimore.
Lynn Perry.
Sister Lynn Perry.
And her son Jonathan Perry.
And Brother Jonathan Perry. Amen. Sister Bree.
Healing for mental health and people with
addictions. Healing for mental health and those battling all types of addictions. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Damon.
I have a prayer for
teenage girl that was last seen in Kalamazoo. Apparently she's missing.
Prayer for the missing teenage girl from Kalamazoo.
And the Wiki family.
And the Wiki family. Amen. Any other? Miss Maddie.
Prayer for healing for Sydney Harris.
Sydney, Sister Sydney Harris.
And special prayer for her
family. And special prayer for the Harris family. Amen. Sister Greta.
Prayer for Nicole and Ashley Brown.
Prayer for Sister Nicole and Sister Ashley Brown. Amen. Yes.
Pray for me.
Pray for Minister Shinee Spicer for the cold that she's caught. Her voice will clear up and all that congestion will be taken care of in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Philip.
Pray for the
Atkins family. Pray for the Atkins family. Amen. Miss Joe.
The entire Atkins
clan. The entire Atkins clan. Amen. Sister Abby.
Pray for
prayer for the
Gwynn family.
Amen. Amen. Pray for Reverend Simpson. Amen. 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 Sister McGeer.
Pray for all of our children and teenagers and their parents and grandparents.
Yes, ma'am.
Special prayer for all of them.
Pray for all our kids and the ones responsible for them. Amen. Brother Will.
Pray for Sister Sarah Cottage, which I care to.
All right, prayer for healing for Sister Sarah Collins. Amen. Sister Ranisha.
Prayer that hundreds of souls are saved across Albion, Michigan and the month of October.
Amen, amen, amen. Pray for souls saved across the city of Albion. Amen, amen. Any other? Ronnie.
Prayer for my old MSU roommate, Brian Skelly, in Massachusetts.
Prayer for your old college roommate, Brother Brian Skelly. Amen. Amen. I want to lift up the, I mentioned it earlier, but the Evans family with Brother Bryce transitioning early this morning over at Vistagram. And also all the residents and the staff of Vistagram Villa in Jackson.
Amen. Amen.
Any other prayers? Sick and shut in, special prayer request? Yes, ma'am.
Prayer of comfort for Reverend Jesse Brown and his family.
Prayer of comfort for Reverend Jesse Brown and the Brown family. Amen. Any other? Sister Alexis.
And just a prayer of strength for those on dialysis.
Prayer of strength for those on dialysis. Amen. I want to throw my mother, Rhonda Gibson, in there for a prayer of healing. She found out some news that she ain't really like today, but we know God is able. So listen, he's got her taken care of, so she'll be all right. Amen.
Amen.
Deacon Boat.
I pray for our special prayer for our climate.
Special prayer.
Global warming. Some people don't really believe it's happening.
Yes, sir.
This is a special prayer.
Special prayer request for our climate. Amen. Amen. Also, I want to throw the striking workers at GM a prayer that the two sides will come together for a beneficial agreement for the company as well as the workers. Amen.
Amen.
This strike don't go on long because it's starting to really affect downstream in the auto industry. Amen?
Amen.
And that just means we're probably going to be paying more for new Cadillacs. So we want them to get that taken care of ASAP. Amen. Sister McGeer. Yes.
A lot of people getting infected with that because a lot of the
counties
refused it for the spray. So
amen.
We just need to pray that nobody gets infected with this.
Amen. Pray that no one gets infected or affected by the EEE virus. Amen. Any other prayers? Sick and shut in, special prayer requests, prayers for the bereaved families. Well, it looks like we've got a lot of prayers to get taken care of, so let's go ahead and put some scripture to those prayers. So for our sick and shut in, an oldie but goodie, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. And it says, and Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. Amen?
Amen.
And then we want to go for our special prayer request. Come on, D. I know it's in Ephesians. Was it Ephesians 3:20?
I'm not sure.
Man, come on now. I don't be like that.
With you on the first one.
What? Yep, Ephesians 3:20. For our special prayer request. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And for the prayers for our bereaved families, we'll go to another. Second Corinthians 1:3-5, which says, "Blessed be the God, be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all comfort, who comforted us in all our tribulation." In all our tribulation, in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ. So that really means that when we don't went through something, we should be able to help somebody else that is going through something right now.
Amen.
Amen. When it comes to the transitioning of a loved one. So let's take 3 minutes on that one. And we'll need a couple prayer partners on this one. So find you a prayer partner. We'll take 3 minutes. We'll stand and petition heaven to interfere in earthly matters. So, ready? Go. Transitioning on our watch and ending up being in hell because we didn't offer them a relationship with our Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, we don't want that to happen.
Even in the church, we can't take it for granted that everybody actually belongs to Jesus.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
And we definitely, Pastor did some, I don't know where he got the statistics from, but in 2017, and most of us remember that, he actually showed us at a prayer service and Bible study where 2/3 of the population of Albion are not affiliated with any ministry. I think it was like, it was 67% is what we saw on the paperwork. That means that if you were to walk by Brother Ronnie, Sister Mary Ann, and Brother Philip on the street, 2 out of 3 of them is on their way to hell. And that's just real talk. So we can never ever forget why we are here. It ain't to have the best food or the best dance and even the best preaching. Or the best hospitality, the best parking lot, none of that. It is to actually help the lost be found.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It has to be. If we're not getting souls saved, we ain't doing nothing. Amen. If there aren't people joining this ministry for real, actually hearing the gospel presented, and it's actually causing them to stop, think about what they're currently doing and actually make a moral decision to turn from doing things their way and being their own boss and actually following the boss. If that's not happening on a consistent basis, we know we still got work to do.
Amen.
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 And it ain't just the responsibility of the ministers. It ain't just the responsibility of the deacons. It ain't the responsibility of the trustees or the choir or any other particular ministry. God gave each one of us that charge.
Amen.
We're supposed to actually live a life that's pleasing to God, blesses other people, and actually causes them to see the light and minister and train around these. Like, okay, what's different about you? I know how you used to be. There's something different about you. What you doing? What's going on with you? Who is this Jesus dude you always talking about? I asked him, okay, man, what are you going to do? I don't know. What do you want to do? I don't know. But I know I don't want this, this, and this. That individual is lost. That individual actually needs to know about our Lord and Savior. He knows something is missing on the inside, but he can't put his finger on what it is. It's people like that that we are responsible for getting this word to. Not by just what we say, but how we live. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So with that being said, let's put some scripture to it. Amen?
Amen.
I'm just going to use one of my favorites, Romans 10:9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So it is our responsibility as the ones who know God, the ones who have an intimate relationship with him, to actually pursue those that don't know him. So when you listen, with your prayer party, just call out some names. If you can't say for sure that this person is saved, throw their name out there. But call down heaven to interfere in that person's life, because you could be actually delivering them from hell. Amen. With these prayers. Amen?
Amen?
So for one, let's do 2 minutes on that. For 2 quick minutes, let's pray Romans 10:9, that we can get everybody saved here in Albion and in the surrounding areas. Amen?
Amen.
2 minutes on that one. With your prayer partner standing, let's go.
Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead.
they shall be saved. So we have a message from the Word of God. Deliver it is lost souls that they will be found and they will receive the gift of eternal life. Help us to be able to minister and to share the gospel with many people.
Last night on October 1, they had the Step Africa at Washington Gardner. I know they had it because I saw on Facebook some of our members screaming and yelling and them kind of things. So I'm sure that was a great event. But on October 8th, we're going to be screening of Amazing Grace, a live concert film documenting the recording of Aretha Franklin's Transcendent Gospel album, and that'll be at the Bone Theater. 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. on October 8th. And then on October 28th, Albion Big Read celebration with, Lord Jesus won't be able to pronounce his name. I'm going to spell it for you and y'all can pronounce it however you want.
All right, all right.
The first name is I-B-I. His last name is Z-O-B-O-I. So however that's pronounced, praise God for it. Author of this year's Big Read book, Pride, and that'll be at the Bone also. And so that announcement will be in the vestibule if you intend to be a part of Big Read. And we believe in reading. Reading is fundamental. So I want to invite any and all members. If you are a member of the Macedonia Church or if you are part of the Albion community, and you just want to know more word. Who's going to know more about the Bible? You know what you know, but you want to know some more. On Tuesdays at 6:30, we are doing now because we've had people join church, but the new members don't seem to show up no more. They join church, and that's good enough, I guess. They already know everything. So we decided to do some teaching for the people who already know a lot, but you just want to know some more. And we're crafting this thing, if you will. Now, new members is actually for new members, and we still do that. So if you're a new member, then we still need you to go through your new members orientation. But this class is the advanced version.
All right. Okay.
We do about 5 or 6 classes for new members, but this class is probably going to be somewhere along the lines of anywhere from 15 to 20 classes.
Mm-hmm.
It is going to address biblically some stuff you wanted to know and you just didn't know.
Amen.
For instance, you saved. You've been rolling with God for a minute. But how do you actually really for real hear from God? You saved. You've been rolling for a minute. But what does it really mean to walk with God? How do you spend time and manage your time from a biblical perspective? How do you really know how to pray? How do you really know how to worship? What is your biblical responsibility as a Christian?
All right.
Who are you? And who does the Bible say that you are? Now that you're saved. How do you handle adversity? How do you keep your mind stayed on Him? The Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. How do you keep your mind stayed on? How do you stop your mind from wandering? They say focus. So, if you have opportunity, you are invited to come out and hang out with us on Tuesdays. Now, the only Tuesday that doesn't work is the second Tuesday of the month when we have our strategic leadership meeting. And so, if you just want to know more about Word, ain't nobody going like, I thought you went through new learning. No. Just come on out. We have 3 witnesses at least that can tell you it will be worth your time. With those 3 witnesses, please stand at this time. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Thank you, witnesses. We talked about Christian giving last night. And I guarantee you, you will never, ever hear Christian giving talk like we taught it last night. I guarantee you. It ain't just we trying to get some money out of you. But if by the time we finish, if you don't want to give something wrong with you. I taught the lesson I wanted to give myself.
You left the money.
Man, I want to give. So you're invited. Watch this. Those of you who were a part of the planning meeting that we had last October, raise your hand if you're here. Okay. If you were there, you know you were there. We was in the conference room. We're going to have that meeting again. That meeting will be held on October the 12th. And so all of you who was invited last year, you're invited again. And then I'm going to, by invitation only, give some invites to some other people. So I will be handing you who is going to be invited some invites. And if you're able to make it, then I would be privileged and honored to have you there. Listen, if you can't make it, it's cool. Don't try to change up nothing. If you just can't make it, you can't make it. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What time did you say that is on Tuesdays?
That would be at 6:30. Yeah. We stopped the 3 o'clock class because wasn't nobody showing up. Well, basically, y'all stopped the 3 o'clock class. Because wasn't nobody showing up. So, 6:30 on Tuesday. And listen, just come in. You ain't got to say nothing. Just come in, bring a little pencil, paper, or whatever, and let's get it in. All right? I'm needing to start our teacher's training again. We did not have that teacher's training class. Yes?
What time on October 12th?
October 12th is probably going to be noon till 3. Okay. Noon till 3. And let me just say this very carefully so y'all hear. Refreshments will be served, and I personally will be providing the refreshments.
Wow, thank you.
Amen. So y'all get to dine on my dime. Yeah. Everybody will get one hamburger and a couple of forks. One soda and some straws. Teacher's training. If some of you already know that you're going to need to go to teacher's training, I've already talked to you, and then there's some others who need to come and talk to me about your availability because you need to be trained to teach. And then all other teachers, you are not required, but you are welcome to come back for a refresher. Amen?
Amen.
And that will be, we will have teacher's training this Saturday at 2 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. Amen?
Amen.
This is a, well, I'm just going to say, listen. Let me thank everybody who actually had a t-shirt on this past Sunday.
Amen.
Especially all of you who got your t-shirt and paid for it. Now anybody, and I mean anybody, got a t-shirt, and you have not paid for that shirt, I will be requesting that payment.
Amen.
ASAP.
Amen.
Whomever you may be. This is non-discriminatory.
Amen.
Everyone. For we as a church, we made a decision that we were going to order shirts. And in ordering the shirts, it was whoever ordered a shirt paid for it.
That was the deal.
So we are a church of integrity.
Amen.
And we're holding everyone to the same standard.
Amen.
I have paid for my shirt. And if anybody has a shirt and you didn't pay for it yet, you can see one gentleman actually tonight. Would that gentleman please stand? Praise God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. All right.
And let me just say it this way, and I say this with all love in my heart.
Amen.
If you have a shirt, we do not want that shirt back. Once you get the shirt, bring the payment. Everybody cool?
Amen.
Amen. That's no exception.
Amen.
I'm going to say it one more time.
No exception.
No exception. If you ain't sure you paid, you didn't pay. If it's a long discussion, you didn't pay. And if you got a shirt, don't bring that shirt back.
Amen.
Don't want that shirt back. Bring the money. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And if anybody have any discussion with me, like, man, Pastor, why are you making such a big deal about this? Come see me afterwards and I'll explain it to you.
Amen.
I really will. I really will. There is a specific reason that I am highly emphasizing this.
Amen.
Okay? All right. Let's do some Bible study. Y'all look real good tonight. Yeah, we can go ahead and hand out the little lesson. Turn with me to Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. Let me ask this, because the first Sunday is coming. Oh, yeah, yeah. First Sunday is coming up. First Sunday in October. So we're going back to our normal attire. And all leaders, leaders being deacons, trustees, preachers, red and black.
Red and black.
Red and black. Red and black. So if you show up here with your red and white on, I know you're going to hear me. Red and black. Red and black. Red and black. It's Sunday. Yes, sir. That's what I wanted to know. I was going to ask that question. So we're going to try to get in and out of this lesson kind of quick. You'll notice it's only one page. I may or may not mean anything. We're going to try to get in and try to get out. All right. Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, verse 10 through 22. This month, we're in the new month. We're in the month of October. The teaching and preaching topics for the month of October is, it actually says comfort zone, but getting out of your comfort zone and servanthood. Serving. Everybody getting it. And listen, we've been saying it over and over, but I'm going to say it again since you hadn't heard me say it a whole lot. We need every single member of Macedonia in ministry. If you've been in this church as a member of this church for more than a year and you're not in ministry, we certainly need you in ministry. And the person I need you, there's a certain person I need you to see. Would that person please stand at this time? Look at that. Everybody just know their job. I love it. I love it. See, Minister Spicer, we need everybody serving. Okay? So watch this. We're going to talk a little bit tonight. Well, let's just get into it. The name of our lesson tonight is This Is Not Comfortable For Me. This is not comfortable for me. I'm going to talk about getting out of your comfort zone and how to actually push through stuff that ain't comfortable for you for the cause of Christ. All right? This is not comfortable for me. Let's just read that set of scriptures and then we're going to do a little talking. Acts chapter 9, verse number 10 through verse number 22. Can I get someone with a outside voice?
Yes, sir.
Read.
And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias.
Uh-huh.
And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus.
Mm-hmm.
For behold, he prayeth, and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
And here he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto thee, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. And I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, hath sent thee, that thou mayest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately
There fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized.
My God.
And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. 21. And all that heard him were amazed and said, is not this he that destroyed them which called on his name in Jerusalem and came hither for that intent that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased more in strength and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. The word of God.
Have you ever been asked or felt a need to do something that you really was not comfortable doing?
Yeah.
Even if it was the right thing.
Yeah.
It was outside of your comfort zone.
Uh-huh.
For some of us, praying publicly is not comfortable, even though you know it is the right thing. What are some things that are not comfortable for you to do?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You're going to teach us training tonight. Oh, y'all thought she did read. She asked y'all a question. Let me push it one more time, since y'all was like ignored what she said. Have you ever been asked or felt a need to do something that you really was not comfortable doing, even if it was the right thing?
Oh, big time.
Whatever it was outside of your comfort zone. For some of us, praying publicly, man, you might as well, you'd rather take a beating. Just like, knock me out if you want to. Rather than make me get up in front of folk and pray.
Amen.
Even though praying is the right thing to do.
Yes, sir.
So talk to me. What are some things that you are not comfortable with, but you know it's the right thing to do? Alright, I'm gonna have y'all come up here and pray. Go ahead. Come into prayer.
Like you all do the
yeah.
I come at 7.
You come at 7. Okay? I want you to push past that. But she come at 7 because she's not comfortable praying in a group setting. Alright? What else you ain't comfortable with that you know is good to do? Yes, ma'am.
People use the expression cold calling. So when you just go out and knock on doors with strangers who don't know, evangelize.
Now we get away. So praying publicly in group settings and doing a cold call evangelistic effort. Just go up and knock on somebody's door or just go up and approach somebody and present the gospel. That is not comfortable. Yes, ma'am.
Reading out loud.
Reading out loud. Reading. How come, you know, you can like reading and under your breath and it just makes sense? And then when you read out loud, like you never forgot how to read. You get the skipping words and can't track one sentence to the next. Jump down like 2 sentences. It's not comfortable. Yes, ma'am.
Testifying.
It's not comfortable. Because somewhere along the lines, somebody became a professional testifier, and they just make it sound so good. In some kind of way, and they testify, they always come out to be the hero, too. And I was doing this, and I just did this right here, praise God. And your testimony just don't never sound good enough. It just don't never sound worth nothing. Yes, ma'am.
Leading a song.
Leading a song.
Amen.
Some people are just built for the background.
Amen.
I can play the background. I can play the background. Some people are just built for the background. And some people can't wait to get that mic.
Amen.
Some of us
It's Tito Marlin, Jackie, and then there's some Michaels. But some people, we the Jackson folk. What are some other things? Yes, ma'am.
Saying amen and hallelujah out loud.
Saying amen and hallelujah out loud. That's uncomfortable. I ask the congregation,
right,
when we are preaching or teaching, talk to us. And some people, that ain't comfortable for them. Because you don't know when to say it. By the time you get your amen out, I'm talking again. And now, or what is it? Or
in a song, calling up scripture,
oh,
while you're trying to sing the song, if then you have that break where there's music, and you have to come up with some scripture to go along with what you're saying.
So you can sing, now you got to exhort the people in the middle of the song, and remember and quote scripture accurately,
right,
in church where folks know scripture. It just ain't your comfort. Just ain't your comfort zone. Yes.
Yeah. When you're teaching a Bible class, and sometimes people ask you questions, and you don't really have an answer for them, that can make you uncomfortable.
You done did all your little studies.
Yes, sir.
And there's gonna be at least one person that figured out one thing to ask you that you were prepared for. Now, I will tell you, I know people who used to go to Bible studies to trip up the teacher. They catch wind of what you're teaching, and they would try you and challenge you. Then, my advice to teachers, because that's uncomfortable, you're out of your comfort zone, you're like, but let me tell you how to get in your comfort zone when you're going to happen. I don't know. Oh, you're trying to ask me a question I don't know? That's easy. Ask me that question again. Blah, blah, blah. I don't know. We already cool again. Because I'm going to tell you flat out, I don't know everything in this Bible. I don't. And so anybody, it doesn't matter what age you are, anybody can ask me a question that I don't know the answer to. I know we're still on the comfort zone piece, but I'll tell you a question. If you ask me that question, the answer is going to be, I don't know, every single time. Here's the question. Where did dinosaurs come from? I don't know. I ain't gonna sit there and try to come up with no, I don't know. All I know is a dinosaur is really not prevalent to what I need in my life right now. So I am not going out digging up no dinosaur bones, and I'm not studying to actually answer that question, because a dinosaur ain't gonna help you or me get into heaven, not one time. So you can ask me that all day long, and the answer gonna be the same. I don't know. Praise God,
hallelujah.
So if you was thinking about asking me about dinosaurs, I already didn't get your answer. I don't know.
I like that.
And now I'm back in my comfort zone.
Amen.
What are some other things? Yes, ma'am.
Fitting the sermon in a short time frame.
Ooh. Ooh. Now for preachers. Ooh. Because we live in a... there was a time... let me just talk about my life. I was born in the very late 60s, 1968. So I grew up in the 70s and 80s. At that time, it was natural for everybody to go to church. Yeah. And you were going to be in church for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
You were going to be there on time, and you were going to be there for a long time. Yeah. Then once you got away from church, they're going to bring you back to church. Because they mess around and do BTU, some kind of training, home missions, red circle, all that stuff. You're going to be at church a long time. And the preachers, they preached a long time. Because they knew you weren't going nowhere. That day is gone. A preacher that has a tendency to preach too long, he or she is already forecasting that you ain't going to be there listening to it. So every real good preacher ought to actually just put it internally in their mind, you got a good 20, no more than 30 minutes to capture and hold their attention. But for some, you don't even get 20 minutes. So when you got to compact what God said and give it to people who don't want you to talk too long, and now you start stumbling over your words, you get nervous, you're trying to make sure it makes sense, you're trying to push that thing out and be impactful, and you can already know in your mind somebody got you on the clock. You got about another 5. It's outside your comfort zone. Any others? Yes, ma'am. Talking about money, it's like your comfort zone.
Hang with me, baby. That's my daughter. That's my spiritual daughter. We just need to spend a little more time. No, for some people it is very, very uncomfortable talking about money. Yes.
Confrontation at work.
Confrontation anywhere. It's not comfortable when you know you're going to have a confrontation with somebody. Because you know what? It's crazy because a lot of people may be fighting, but they don't tell you they're fighting with you. This guy arguing with you for no reason.
You're good at that.
I have acquired a certain skill set. Any others? Getting outside your comfort zone. Things that are not comfortable for you. What if, yes, go ahead.
Standing up talking to people.
Standing up talking, public speaking in any kind of way.
Yeah.
Listen, most people, I'm blessed to do what I do. And for some, you say, man, you may just make it look so easy, you don't get nervous no more. Like, for real? Every Sunday morning, I gotta get in that pulpit and preach. I get nervous every Sunday morning. Yes, ma'am.
It's not mindful like dancing in front of people.
Dancing in front of people. I like how you said that, Amara. She's like, it ain't mine. I'm cool. But for some people, this joke. Just walk into a room trying to find you a seat. Yes, sir. Asking for help. Yes, ma'am. Talking about your personal life to help others. And I'm gonna throw a little caveat on that. Talking about your personal life to help others, or just talking about your personal life and you ain't proud of it. Yes.
Sometimes it's hard to admit you got a problem.
To admit I ain't perfect. To admit I made a mistake. I mean, I made a mistake one time. It was like 1975.
Had a hard time thinking about it and talking about it. Even today.
To admit that you are human. To admit, you know what, I made a mistake. And that ain't comfortable. Because I want you to think highly of me. But if I really be transparent, are you still going to respect me and admire me? That's not comfortable. Yes?
And the flip side of that is to say I'm sorry.
And to say I'm sorry. Because I don't want to be wrong anyway. Good.
All right. Those are some good ones. Those are some good ones. So let's get into it. Let's see. God has a way of putting us in uncomfortable situations. Not to embarrass us, but to grow us and to get the greatest kingdom production from us. Some of the times when you actually go into and then come out on the other side of what's uncomfortable for you, you actually come out better than you went in. Many times it's because you took a chance and stepped out of your comfort zone that you actually grew in ways you could not have ever imagined. Because your mind will always play tricks on you that, oh, this is going to be embarrassing for you. They ain't going to like you no more. This is going to work out for your bad. But then all of a sudden you kind of, I'm going to take a chance.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm just going to trust God this one time.
Amen.
I'm so uncomfortable, I'm nervous. My anxiety is like off the charts right now. I ain't feeling like I'm in control, but I'm just going to try God this one time.
Mm-hmm.
And the next thing you know, like, that wasn't too bad.
Amen.
Usually, reality is a lot less than your thoughts.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's
true.
Yeah.
Usually. We will actually terrify our own selves about what might happen. And so I'm going to stay in my comfort zone because I'm safe here. And watch this. Some of our comfort zones is horrible. But it's a known horror. I'd rather have a known horror sometimes. Because I'm comfortable than an unknown possible solution.
Amen. Amen.
That's amazing.
What I think might be over there, I'm not willing to put myself out there. So I'm going to stay in what's comfortable and safe for me. Can I tell somebody, many of us have control issues, and hardly any of us are in control of anything.
Yeah, that's right, Pastor. What a word. You're preaching sermon on that.
Sweet Lord Jesus. And the God we serve, He loves us so much that He won't let us stay weak when we think we're strong. Because when we actually are weak, that's when we actually are strong. When we think we're strong and we got it all together, I just want to hold on to what I can hold on to. He will allow us to be put in situations to make sure you and I both know you ain't got nothing under control. You ain't got your mind under control. You ain't got your body under control. You ain't got your emotions under control. You ain't got your mouth under control. You ain't got your eyes, your hands, your feet. You ain't got nothing under control without me. Because most of us have gotten to a point in our comfort zone where we actually don't really need God. We've been there so long. Like, I got this on lock. I know exactly what's going to happen in this space right here. And we don't even realize, not only are we not growing, we are regressing. Because our comfort zone is so comfortable. Ooh, Jesus. So successful. I'm teaching them.
Keep coming back.
Let's look at some, look at a couple of scriptures. And we're quick sometimes. We'll, like, God put us in a situation like, no, I ain't doing that. I ain't doing that. No, you got the wrong dude. You got the wrong girl up in this piece. Like, you, listen, you must be talking about them. You must be talking about me. Doing that? No. Watch this. Exodus chapter 3.
Yes, sir.
Exodus chapter 3. I just want to show you when you really want to stay in your comfort zone. Kind of some of the speech that will happen that will come up out of your mouth. Now here is God calling Moses to go
back to Egypt and talk to Pharaoh.
Right.
Now, y'all know this story.
Yeah.
He called Moses by showing him a burning bush.
Yeah,
yeah. Now, the amazing thing is a bush was burning.
Yeah.
That wasn't amazing.
No,
because in the backside of the desert, a bush burning was usual.
Very common, yeah.
The problem was, the bush didn't burn up.
No.
Right, right.
And even more troubling than I would call trouble, a voice started coming out of the bush. And watch this. You don't really see Moses, and we're going to read the scripture, you don't see him really kind of getting upset about that. But when God told him to go back into an uncomfortable situation, then he gets uncomfortable.
Right.
Like a bush talking, burning, the whole time it's talking, it don't burn up. And it's just talking to me. And I'm comfortable. What am I trying to say before we get to Moses? Some of this stuff that's comfortable for us ought to be the stuff we don't run from.
Right. Right.
Say that again,
Doc. Say that again.
There's some voices talking to us.
Yep.
That actually are talking, and we should not be comfortable with listening to that
voice.
That's
right.
That's
good.
But that don't bother you. But to come to church and sit up and read a scripture, you get to shaking like a leaf. So watch this. Exodus chapter 3, starting at verse 7.
And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows.
Keep rolling.
And I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt.
Verse 11.
And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?
It's already there. You're like, first of all, who am I that I'm a guy? Why you choose me? And who am I to go back and tell Pharaoh anything? Like, God, don't you know he actually got a warrant out for my house? I ain't been over here for like 40 years. I was running from him when I came over here. Now, I'm comfortable right here, right now. I done put my little life together. It ain't much, but it's mine. I'm out here watching these sheep. The sheep ain't bothering me, and I ain't bothering the sheep. Now you're trying to send me that. Who am I to go back and talk to Pharaoh? Verse 13, watch this.
And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers have sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?
Moses is putting together every defense on why I ain't getting out of my comfort zone. I am on the backside of Midian. I have now a wife and two kids.
Uh-huh.
I got some sheep that I look after every day. I've been watching these sheep for 40 years.
Right.
I got this on lock.
Right.
I ain't trying to go back and do none of that stuff that you're talking about, God, because that is not my comfort zone.
Amen.
My comfort zone is here. What you telling me to do is over there.
Yes,
I do here. I don't do there. I do me, and me is better here than over there.
Amen. Amen.
He is calling up every one of his fears. Verse number, chapter 4, verse number 1.
And Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me.
They ain't gonna believe me.
Nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee.
Verse number 10.
And Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore, nor since thou hast spoken unto thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue.
Most of us, if not all of us, only want to do the stuff we know we're good at.
Yeah, right.
Anything that we could possibly mess up, we don't want to do it. Some of us got that perfection type of mentality. Listen, you want me to do something new? First of all, I'm going to slide behind, away from everybody. I'm going to practice first. And I'm going to get as much practice in as I can. Cause I ain't going to be out there looking stupid. I love Albion, but especially in Albion, like, oh, no, me here. Ain't no me up in here. Listen, quick story. I was at my brother's homegoing earlier this year, and while I was there, we had did the homegoing. It was back at the repast, and a lot of my friends that I worked with when I was lived over there, they started showing up, and one of my great friends, co-workers, a lady that she, you talking about, diva down. She wanted to see me, but she didn't want to come inside where everybody was because at that time she had a pair of sweats on and she didn't have time to go home and put her heels on. And so here's what she told me. She said, tell Bobby to come out here. I can't come in there because they know me up in this piece. I got my sweats on, and I got some flats on, because when I go up in there, I got to have my heels on. Most of us refuse to move into an area where we're not sure we're going to come out looking good. Moses is like, man, I can't even talk. He is believing he had a stuttering problem. He's like, I ain't going back over there talking to him. I ain't working on my little speech in 40 years. And who I'm going to say sent me? And why should they listen to me? I ain't getting out of my comfort zone. Listen to this. Comfort and being in our comfort zones is a luxury, not a necessity.
All right. Okay. Luxury. Okay.
It is good when you can be in your comfort zone and do what God called you to do.
Yeah.
But it's not necessary.
All right.
It's a luxury,
amen.
But it's not a necessity. Being comfortable is not a prerequisite to obeying God.
Thank God for that.
Come on, Doc.
Anybody ever said this? Because I don't want you talking about nobody but you. Anybody ever said this? When I get myself together.
Oh, yeah, I said that. I'm going to come to the Lord. Yeah.
Wait. Y'all ain't never got that. Let me talk to people on Facebook Live. Said, when I get myself together, I'll do this, that, and the other. Let me tell you what's wrong with that statement. First of all, you can't get yourself together. Second of all, you the only one know when you actually get it together, so you ain't got no specific time frame. Because you was the one who determined you didn't have it together. So you making up your own rules in your own comfort zone.
I love
you can be in your comfort zone for the next 50.
I'm already
And can't nobody push you out.
Amen.
Because when you get it together, and can somebody explain to me exactly when win is? Sweet Lord Jesus. Watch this. Obedience is primary, comfort is secondary.
Yes, sir.
Exodus chapter 4, verse 11 through 17. Let's just read those. We're going to read them straight through, and then we're going to get on.
And the Lord said unto him,
yep.
Who hath made man's mouth?
Mm-hmm.
Or who maketh the dumb or deaf, or the seeing or the blind?
Mm-hmm.
Have not I the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, O my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him whom thou wilt send.
Mm-hmm.
And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses.
Stop right there. A lot of us don't think about the fact that when we're resisting God because we don't want to move from what's comfortable for us, that we actually are making God mad.
Disobedience.
Because God is already saying, I have provided everything you're going to need. And what I love now, what I love is this. We will grab a seat.
Amen.
And I'm going to sit right here until God show me exactly what I'm supposed to do. And I ain't going to move until I get every detail. Yet the more details he give you,
the more you sit.
You start crossing your legs. You start laying back on it. I'm like, I ain't doing all that. More details actually put you closer and more pressed down in your seat.
Come on, boy.
And we never think about, how long is God mad with me?
Because
you don't see God getting specifically angry with an individual too much in Scripture. You'll see him getting angry with nations. But that Scripture says his anger was kindled against Moses. Now put your name there.
Yeah. Put your name in there for the moment.
You ain't moved out of your comfort zone, whatever that area is. Because remember that the name of this lesson is, this is not comfortable for me. You the only one know what this is.
Amen.
Mm. So, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Bobby.
My God.
The anger of the Lord was kindled against Shawnette.
Amen.
The anger of the Lord was kindled against Cedric.
Amen.
The anger of the Lord was kindled against John. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Philip. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Marianne. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Ryan.
Amen.
The anger of the Lord was kindled against Rhinesha.
Amen.
The anger of the Lord was kindled against Markeisha. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Esther. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Stephanie. The anger of the Lord was kindled against whoever you are. For one reason, and one reason only, because he didn't want to move out of his comfort zone. Sweet Jesus. Come on, Seth. Keep reading, man. You're holding me up.
And he said, is not Aaron the Levite thy brother?
Mm-hmm.
I know that he can speak well. And also, behold, he cometh forth to meet thee. And when he seeth thee, he will be glad in his heart. And thou shalt speak unto him, and put words in his mouth, and I will be with thy mouth, and with his mouth, and will teach you what ye shall do. And he shall be thy spokesman unto the people. And he shall be, even he shall be to thee instead of a mouth, and thou shalt be to him instead of God. And thou shalt take this rod in thine hand, wherewith thou shalt do signs.
He said, everything you scared of, I've already provided for you.
Amen.
every single thing that you are afraid of. Because can I just put it out there like this? The biggest reason, the underlying biggest reason that most of us, if not all of us, when we get in a place that is so comfortable that we really don't want to take that next step, it is down to one word and one word only. It's called fear.
Amen.
What could and what would we do if we weren't scared?
Everything.
Think about whatever really for real. See, we can be honest with each other tonight.
All right.
We can be honest tonight. All of us got some fear in us about something.
You're right. You're right.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we in church. Yes, we saved. Yes, the Lord is on our side. But the reality of it is, yes, that's real, but let me tell you what else is real. I'm scared of some things.
Oh, yeah.
But what could we do if we really weren't scared?
Yeah.
Where would this community be? If every single citizen of Albion wasn't really scared of something. It don't matter how small Albion is, because everybody will tell you the location of this city automatically should make this city successful forever.
Right. Amen.
There is no reason this city should ever be down.
You make me feel good.
Except somebody scared.
Let's kill that giant.
Watch this. We're not going to get to the points, but we're going to get to the transition. I'm going to talk through the transition, and we'll pick up the points next week, Lord willing. Let's take a look at a little known disciple. There's a disciple in the Bible that nobody really talks about a lot. His name is Ananias. Many of you didn't even know there was no disciple named Ananias. Because many of you didn't know that it was more than 12 disciples. That's the kind of stuff you'll learn when you come to holler at me on Tuesday.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus chose 12 and he didn't say 12.
Amen.
And he got some more disciples.
Yes, sir.
And one of his disciples was Ananias. And we want to see how Ananias handled what was not comfortable for him. Let me just give you the backdrop of what we're going to be talking about. In Acts chapter 9, we find where Jesus has now been crucified. He has actually gone on back to glory. And the church is now growing by leaps and bounds. But the establishment don't like what's going on in the church. And one of the representatives of the establishment was a dude named Saul. And Saul said, I'm going to stop this church thing. And what I'm going to do, anybody who claims this thing called Christianity, I am going to arrest them, and if I have to, I'll kill them. And he was killing men, women, boys, and girls. And he said, I know how to really shut it down, because I done ran most of the Christians out of Jerusalem. Either they are gone or they're underground, but I know where they are. They're over in Damascus. So he went to the high priest. He got a letter giving him permission to leave Jerusalem, to go to Damascus, to actually go in, and I'm going to go and wreak havoc. I'm going to go and actually arrest everything that ain't nailed down. I'm going to drag it, and if I have to, by horseback, because he was on a horse, by horseback, I'll drag him back here and put him in jail. And if they don't want to go, I'll kill them where they are. And everybody knew he had permission to do it. But on his way, he met a man named Jesus. And if you ever want to get out your comfort zone, I mean have a real encounter with a man named Jesus. I believe that somebody probably need to have another, a new, a fresh encounter with Jesus. You need to probably meet him. Now, it don't mean you ain't saved, but how about meeting him one more time? How about the lover that you had way back when and you ain't seen him for a long time, and all of a sudden you run up on him and have another encounter with him? That's the kind of encounter we need to have with Jesus. An encounter that'll make us fall in love with him one more time. And when we fall
it one more time, all of a sudden, what was holding us back, oh, we're ready to do whatever He wants us to do. He'll just make us feel light on our feet. He'll make us want to say yes when we used to say no. It's just a fresh encounter. And Saul had a fresh encounter with a man named Jesus. Ah! But his encounter with Jesus caused another disciple named Ananias to have to get out of his comfort zone.
Amen.
And next week, Lord willing, we'll pick up with what he did that will teach us how to handle when something, when this is not comfortable for me.
Mm-hmm.
Is that all right?
That's all right.
Yes, sir.
Pretty good little teaser there.
Yeah.
Question comes to concern. Everybody cool? Everybody cool? Let's stand and be dismissed. We got some training to do and conversations to have. If I were back in this seat, I said we have some lies to tell, but we ain't gonna do that tonight. We ain't gonna tell some lies. Praise God, praise God. Let me remind everybody, I'm the poster child of it now. Take care of yourselves.
Amen.
All right, stay healthy.
Amen.
Stay on top of your health.
Amen.
Get them doctor visits in.
Amen.
Do what they tell you to do.
Amen.
Don't go to the professional and then decide you the professional.
You know more than the doctor.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, he told me, he tried to put me on this mess, but I ain't taking it. You done paid them to tell you something you ain't going to do.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we love you tonight. We adore you. We know that we have been in some area of our lives,
yeah,
in our comfort zone, and we really didn't want to move.
Yeah.
But even tonight, we have actually had a fresh encounter with you.
Yes.
We hear you talking to us through your word into our situation.
Yes.
And we already feel ourselves getting ready to move out of our comfort zone.
Yes.
Even when we really don't want to,
yes,
for the cause of Christ.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you right now that you have kept us in your grace and mercy. Has kept us even when we were disobedient and didn't want to do what you told us to do.
Yeah, yeah.
But because you loved us so much, you kept giving us another chance.
Yeah.
And another chance, yeah, and another chance.
Yeah.
And we say to you, thank you.
Thank you.
And we say to you, this time, we're ready to obey.
Yeah.
We love you tonight,
yeah,
that we have already grown and we're looking forward to growing even more. Because we love you too much to stay where we are.
Yeah.
We thank you right now, God, for blessing and keeping this congregation and this community.
Yeah.
Lord, you know what we stand in the need of.
Yeah.
Clean us up.
Yeah.
Wash us with your word.
Yeah.
Wash our hearts and our minds,
yeah,
God. Allow us to be what you called us to be.
Yeah.
Lord, I call forth healing on this entire congregation right now. In the name of Jesus, God. The things that scared us even about our health, we're not scared anymore. We actually face it with the promise that you went through all the cities and villages and you heal all sickness and diseases. And so we know that if you did it one time, you'll do it again. We thank you right now, God, for all being well in our world now. And our new comfort zone is our comfort zone in you. For you said that we are with you in heavenly places. So we are wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in you at a whole different level. And we receive every precious promise that you have for us. And now, God, as we leave this place, but never your presence, God, we leave with a renewed and a refreshed love for you and a new, renewed and fresh love for each other.
Yes.
We thank you that all is well with our families,
yes,
all is well with our homes,
yes,
all is well with our finances, all,
yes,
is well with our health.
Yes.
And we call those things to be not as though they were.
Yes.
And we believe that tonight, God,
yes,
we'll rest in your care.
Yes.
We thank you right now for a good night's sleep.
Yes.
A good night rest,
yes,
even colds that have jumped on us, God,
yes,
we rebuke them in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And just a good night rest is going to make it all right.
Yes.
Thank you right now for all that you're doing.
Yes.
Continue to have mercy upon us.
Yes.
Love us in spite of us.
Yes.
Keep us in perfect peace with our minds stayed on you.
Yes.
We love you tonight in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Hug somebody, tell them you love them.
Yes.